We're going to turn, please, to Proverbs and the chapter 31. Proverbs and the chapter 31. Then we'll also read some words from 1 Peter chapter 3. Proverbs chapter 31. And we're reading from the verse 10. From verse 10 through to the end of the chapter. And we have an acrostic poem. And so each of the verses begins with the next letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So the equivalent of our letter A for verse 10, the equivalent of our letter B for the verse 11, and so on. And so 22 verses, the 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Verse 10, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax, and worketh willingly with her hands. She is like the merchant's ships. She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night, and giveth meat to her household, and a portion to her maidens. She considereth the field, and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands she planteth a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength, and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She layeth her hands to the spindle, and her hands hold the distaff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor, yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honour are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household. She eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. And then we'll turn, please, to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter and the chapter 3. 1 Peter 3. And we're going to read the first 7 verses, and we'll have this as congregational reading, so I'll read the verses with the odd numbers, and if you read the verses with the even numbers, so the congregation are reading the verses 2, 4, and 6. So verse 1, likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives. While they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear. Whose adorning? Let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold or putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. For after this manner in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters ye are, as long as ye do well, and are not afraid with any amazement. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, give honour unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. And then, knowing the Lord will add blessing to the reading of his precious and valuable truth. We're going to turn in our hymn books, please, to the hymn 713. 713. As we sing these words, please, we will remain seated. So remaining seated as we sing 713. The offering for God's work will be received. If you didn't come prepared for the offering, please just let the band pass by. 713. It is a thing most wonderful, almost too wonderful to be, that God's own Son should come from heaven and die to save a child. 713. Remaining seated. Thank you. Turning, please, in our Bibles again to Proverbs 31. Proverbs chapter 31, and in verse 10, it says, "Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies." Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. We'll look to the Lord together, please, in prayer. Let us ask the Lord for his help as we come together around his word. Our gracious Father, we thank thee for help already through the service this morning. And we need thy help now as we come to meditate upon the words that are before us. O Lord, grant help from above, we pray. Seal thy holy truth to each waiting heart. And we pray, Lord, that there will be, even in this passage, some words of truth that are not only a challenge, and we ask for that, but words of comfort to every believer. And we pray for any without thee, that their eyes might be opened to see their lack of excellence and personal virtue. And we pray today that they will be brought to flee to Jesus Christ for mercy. Grant that help of the Spirit, then we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. And Matthew Henry, as he commented on this beautiful poem in Proverbs chapter 31, towards the latter part of his comments, he made these words, or he spoke these words, that this chapter is like a looking glass for women. It's like a looking glass for women. Of course, he wasn't saying that it's only that, but as he said that, he was suggesting that a Christian lady then should come to this chapter. She should open it up, as it were, and look into the looking glass, and he said she should dress herself according to it. If they do so, their adorning will be found to praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Now, thinking about the image of the looking glass, the looking glass that is described in Proverbs 31 is very different than the looking glass that our society would provide for the lady at this particular time. If we were to ask people around us, what does the ideal woman look like? The answers that they would give are entirely different to what is set forth here in Proverbs chapter 31. And therefore, it's vital for us all that our thinking is molded not by society, but by Scripture. Yet, coming back to that comment of Matthew Henry, that this chapter is like a looking glass, that surely presents a huge challenge. For the lady that is described in Proverbs 31 certainly looks like a lady that is holding it all together. She is a lady with huge responsibility, yet in everything that seems to be presented to her, she fulfills it. As I was reading this chapter over and over in the past week, I almost felt tired trying to follow this lady through her daily work. It's exhausting almost reading through the chapter as to all that this lady can accomplish. And yet reading through the poem, there are many things that this lady surely must have done that aren't even mentioned, or certainly there's not much attention given to them. And so this lady is a lady that has children. Perhaps they are now grown. But we do read of how in verse 28 her children rise up and call her blessed. But there's no mention in the chapter of dressing the babies or changing their nappies, of washing them, of ensuring the education of our children. And so there are many things that this lady engages in that aren't even described here. And yet, the things that are described, how many are described? And I can understand that the lady that would read through Proverbs 31 and say, this is not like me. I nowhere near come up to the standard that is set in Proverbs chapter 31. I believe that that is actually part of the purpose of the chapter. Like every other part of Scripture, this is intended to be convicting. This is intended to be confronting. And it is not just to be confronting to the lady. And so we don't want any of the men to go home today and say, you are not the Proverbs 31 lady. Rather, you ought to be, as men, asking yourself the question, am I the husband that is enabling my wife to be the Proverbs 31 lady? Am I of such an encouragement to her that this is what she is? Or rather, am I continually vexing her heart? And so she does fall short. Or for the single man might ask the question, is this the type of lady that I'm actually looking for? And so the single man, certainly in our time, looks for many qualities in a young woman. He's not looking for the right qualities. Equally, the young man should ask himself the question, am I the type of man that a Proverbs 31 woman would want to have pursuing her? And then for the single lady, do I find this home that's described in Proverbs 31 attractive? Or is my thinking entirely distorted? And so for us all, no matter where we are in life, I think there is a challenge for us in this particular chapter. It's helpful for us, I think, to recognize that this closing section of the book does not hang in isolation. And so certainly the last two chapters carry these appendices. And so we have had the appendix of Eger, and we also talked about what instruction Lemuel's, King Lemuel's mother, gave. We talked about that last Lord's Day. From verse 10 onwards, we're not actually sure who the writer is. And so some consider that it is still King Lemuel that is talking. And that certainly is supported in the idea of the mother giving instruction. And remember how she was warning about the type of woman that should be avoided, and therefore Proverbs, the latter part of Proverbs 31, seems to continue that theme. Others think that it's a different writer. And so there are these appendices, but as I've said, it's not disjointed. But remember, the opening chapters of the book of Proverbs speak of what we might call lady wisdom, and then lady folly. And so wisdom is presented as a lady, but also folly is presented as an adulterous lady. Wisdom in those opening chapters of Proverbs is actually Christ. And so here's a woman that excels. Proverbs 31:29, many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. And in those words, we are to see that this chapter is certainly pointing us to Jesus Christ. He is the wisdom of God. Here's the wisdom that we must be married to, that we must be joined to. And I'm not saying that we explain away all of the chapter by spiritualizing it. We shouldn't evade the conviction of the chapter. But certainly, we are to run to Christ in reflection this chapter, just as every other part of Scripture. And through him, we are to overcome. Before we get into this, I should say that the woman in Proverbs 31 is not a nun in a convent. The ideal woman is not one that has cut herself off from society or has pledged that she will withdraw from family life. Not at all. Marriage and children are God's norm. Now certainly there are exceptions. Some never meet the right spouse. As for some, their spouse has already passed away. Some cannot conceive children. And of course we could go on and on with various exceptions. But the exceptions do not disprove the rule. And so in Genesis chapter 1, the Lord said, be fruitful and multiply. And Genesis chapter 2 makes it clear that that is in the context of the home. One man and one woman. And so when we come to Proverbs chapter 31, we can see a reflection of this again. There's a home. And this is then the great ideal, as it were. It has never been rescinded. And so want to look then at the Proverbs 31 woman. I want to see first of all with you the scope and the secret of the Proverbs 31 woman. As I said earlier, as I was reading through this chapter in the past week and meditating over it, I felt almost weary trying to follow this lady through her day's work. Some have described her as a domestic queen. And in one sense, she had a very narrow focus. But then, as we'll see in a moment, in another sense, she had an exceeding broad focus. The narrow focus of this is a lady that is focused on her home. This is a lady that sees that her great priority, her great duty lies in the home. Verse 27. She looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of idleness. And she is a helpmeet to her husband. And so she is the Eve, as it were, to Adam. And back in verse 11, the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her. And so the husband goes off in the morning to fulfill various duties, but he trusts his wife. He knows that she is a loyal, trustworthy helpmeet. The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her. Verse 12, she will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. And so here is this narrow focus. She is focused on her own home. She recognizes that that is her priority. And yet, there is flowing from this a very expansive capacity. And there is this great scope, as I'm calling it. You see, some preachers, as they refer or preach from Proverbs chapter 31, give the impression that husbands are those that go out and earn the money, and the ladies are those that spend it. While the husband is working, the wife is at home all day looking after the children. And maybe she does some needlework as well, drawn from Proverbs chapter 31. The lady in Proverbs 31 is doing much more than any of that. She gets the raw materials to make clothing. And so from the whole process of the wool from the fleece spinning it into yarn the whole way through to dyeing the fabric and making the clothing, she is involved in it all. From the harvesting of the flax, the making of linen, through to the making of clothes from the linen, she is involved in it all. And what is not needed, she sells. In other words, if we're going to be faithful to the chapter, what is before us, the lady in Proverbs 31 has contributed to the finances of the home. Now, I'm not saying that every mother must contribute to the finances of the home. In our society, I believe it's right and proper that there is a time that the lady withdraws. And she does focus on her children. That may mean that she is not actually contributing financially to the home. But for those preachers that say that a lady can never help financially in the home and try to use Proverbs 31 as their basis, they're distorting the word of God. There's no other way to say it. For it's very clear that this lady is financially productive. She oversees the growing of food as well as the cooking of it. If you look at verse 16, she considereth a field and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hand, she planteth a vineyard. Again, this is not a lady that is locked up in her home 24 hours a day. Very interesting words in verse 15. She riseth also while it is yet night, and giveth meat or food to her household. And notice these words then. And a portion to her maidens. Now it's very evident that this lady is not poor. She's hard working, but there are times that she is dressed in a very beautiful dress. So in verse 22 it talks about the silk and purple, and the purple dye that was used for the dyeing of clothing was extremely expensive. And so though she's hard working, there are times that she does appear in beautiful clothing. What I want you to notice there in verse 15 is that she is getting up early in the morning to make sure that the maids are well fed. And so we have in our minds the idea of a well-to-do lady having servants, and she just sits back and lets all the servants do the work. And yet here, quite turned on its head, isn't it? This lady is getting up early to make sure that the maids are well fed. She also has concern for the poor. She works, she gives to the poor. And so through the chapter, there are a number of different figures of speech that describe her. She is likened to a merchant ship in verse 14. Because she brings her food from afar. She's got this broad vision. She's heroic. In verse 15, when it says she giveth meat to her household, the word meat there is actually to do with the prey. Many commentators believe that the Hebrew is suggestive that she is like a lion that goes forth, and then as she is caught the prey, she brings it in order to feed the family. Then also, she is soldier-like. Verse 17, she girdeth her loins with strength and strengtheneth her arms. She's a strong lady. Now, she's not in any way rebellious. She's a submissive lady. But she's not in any way hiding in the corner. I was reading some comments of someone writing about this chapter. I don't think the person is a Christian. But he represented the lady as a slave to her husband. And he represented the husband as paying very little attention to his wife. So he takes advantage of this very industrious lady. But to do that, you have to ignore verse 28. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her children also, and he praiseth her. So he doesn't ignore her efforts. He is very aware of them. Then the person says that she does all the work while he lies around doing nothing. Well, again, that is not what the chapter says. Verse 23, her husband is known in the gates. What does that mean? Well, remember, the gates were the place of leadership in the Old Testament. So the elders of the city, they sat in the gate. The judges of the city sat in the gate. The city councillors. And so here is a man, and he has a very important role in that local community. Now, I don't know if he was paid for doing that work, but certainly we can see that his wife undertaking all of this industry enabled him to perform the work in the city gates. She was, as I've said, a helpmate. She complimented her husband. And the question is this: how could she do it? What was her secret? And the secret is found towards the end of the psalm. Verse 30, favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Now remember, this lady is being praised. A woman that feareth the Lord. And it's because this woman is a God-fearer that she is enabled to accomplish what she does do. And so she doesn't say, I have so much that I need to do, I don't have time for the Bible. I don't have time for prayer. I don't have time to meditate upon the things of the Lord. No, that's not what she's saying. She is saying, I have so much to do. I absolutely need to pray. I absolutely need the Bible. I absolutely need the Lord's help in everything that I am to do in the Lord's name. And so she has to deal with many temporal things. But she is able to deal with temporal things because she lives with eternal realities in the forefront of her mind. And so she serves the Lord in her home. She serves the Lord in the field, in the vineyard, at the spindle. Because in all of this, she recognizes I don't do it for myself. I don't even do it only for my husband. I do it first and foremost unto the Lord. She had these eternal realities, but she was not cut off from temporal realities. She was not a poor woman, and she didn't pretend that she was. She could take that purple clothing at the appropriate time, wear it, because she could identify the Lord has given us richly all things to enjoy. What I want to emphasize is this. Her starting point was this: I must live in the fear of the Lord. I must have the Lord as my own. I must have a personal walk with God. Every day I must know him. And as she knew him, she was enabled to be then this woman of Proverbs 31. And so it would be a mistake if tomorrow morning, reflecting on Proverbs 31, that the lady says, I need to go and buy a vineyard today in order to try and be this woman. Or I need to increase my allotment in order to be this woman. Now maybe that will be where you end up being. The starting point has to be this: the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord. And as that is put right, then other things will fall into their right and proper place. The scope and secret of the Proverbs 31 woman. I want to see then, secondly, the virtue and value of the Proverbs 31 woman. In the verse 10, it asks this question: who can find a virtuous woman? Now, our English word virtue, normally when we use that word today, we use it in a moral sense. A lady is virtuous, she is moral. And that's certainly included in the Hebrew word that's being translated here, but it actually is much broader than that. Really, it's very difficult to get one English word that captures it all, and so some have translated it excellent. Who can find an excellent woman? The word includes the idea of strength. It includes the idea of vigor. It includes the idea of valor. So it is a word that is associated with the military. But then it's also a word that is sometimes used to speak of wealth. It's really emphasizing that this is a lady of real character. And how valuable she is. So speaking of the value, her price is far above rubies. The price is far above rubies. And there are great lessons that arise out of this, not just for the ladies, but for us all. And I want to suggest to you that this passage teaches us that we are to pursue what is of real value. Pursue what is of real value. You think of that opening question. Who can find? Who can find a virtuous woman? And the implication is that this is what a young man should seek. A young man should seek to find a virtuous woman. A woman of this excellence. And so he is not to seek out first and foremost a lady of great physique or a lady of great physical beauty. If the lady the Lord gives is that, well and good for him. But so often, the young man and us all can pursue the wrong thing. I was reading last week about a minister in the 19th century who called at the home of a lady on a pastoral visit. And this lady was evidently well-to-do. And she took some time to come to the room where he was waiting for her. And when she came in all of her fashion and all of her finery. And the minister began to weep. And the lady was quite taken aback. And she asked him, "Why are you weeping?" And he said, "I weep, madam, to think that an immortal being should spend so much of that precious time which was given her to prepare for eternity, and thus vainly adorning that body which must so soon become a prey to worms." Now, he was not saying that it's wrong for a lady to look nice, but he recognized that here was a lady that was completely consumed with physical things, with appearance. Her priority was wrong. And remember, this is the focus then in 31. Here is a lady that had the right priority. The fear of the Lord, and then this focus on the home. We are to pursue the right things. Now, in case the ladies feel that the book of Proverbs seems to be all against the ladies, not that at all. Proverbs chapter 20 and the verse 6. Proverbs 20 and the verse 6. Most men will proclaim every one his own goodness. But a faithful man, who can find? And so if the men are thinking, I don't know where these Proverbs 31 women are, have a look in the mirror. Where are the faithful men? We so often pursue the wrong thing. We chase the wrong thing. And so the great challenge of this chapter is this. Will you, by God's grace, pursue what is of true value? Eternal things. But then we are to praise what is of real value. At the end of verse 28, her husband also, he praiseth her. Now, we normally reserve that word praise for the Lord, and yet the same word that is used for the praise of the Lord is taken here to speak of the husband praising his wife. And so he sees the worth of the lady. He sees her value, and he is appreciative of all that she does. And he recognizes that it would not have been good if he was left alone. And so he is thankful that she attends to his good. And there is a challenge then for us, that we would show that appreciation in the home and in other places. Praise what is of real value, but then also protect what is of real value. For remember, this lady is said to have a price that exceeds the value of rubies. Now, if somebody has a ruby, they look after it, they treasure it, they're not careless concerning the ruby. And so the husband is to protect his treasure. He is to prize her. He's certainly not to be a bully to her. We were reading earlier in 1 Peter 3, verse 7, likewise ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, as being heirs together of the grace of life. In thinking about Proverbs 31, it's hard to call her a weaker vessel. But we recognize that the lady is, in a sense, the weaker vessel. The husband is not to despise her for her weaknesses. He is to give honor to her. Protect her. Prize her. Help her, as the woman in Proverbs 31 did, to overcome her natural infirmities. As I said earlier, ultimately, Proverbs 31 directs us to Jesus Christ. Who can find a virtuous woman for her price is far above rubies. Remember how our Lord Jesus Christ is referred to as the pearl of great price. And the merchant man, as he had spent his life buying and selling pearls, as he came and saw the pearl of great price, he was willing to let go of all that he had in order to have that one precious pearl. And it speaks of how, through our pursuit in life, we ought to be willing to let go of everything in order that we might have Christ and his salvation, in order that we might continually cling to him. Today then, I ask the question, are you married to Lady Wisdom? You bowed yourself before Almighty God and said, I turn from my folly, I
turn to the wisdom of Jesus Christ. And as you've turned to Jesus Christ, do you walk every day with Him? Is your focus on Him every day? Do you glean from Him every day? Pursuing Him, praising Him, preserving that walk that you have with Him. Boaz said of Ruth in Ruth chapter 3, verse 11, "Now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman." Boaz then used the very same Hebrew language as is used here in Proverbs 31 to describe Ruth. He said, "I will perform all that is needed." So in a most wonderful way, our Lord Jesus is not only the fulfillment of the virtuous woman, He is the fulfillment of the faithful husband. He is the one that has paid the price to take a bride to Himself. He is the one that has fulfilled all of the obligations that we could not fulfill in order that He might have a bride to Himself. Therefore, while yes, Proverbs 31 is a most searching chapter, praise God, we are directed to the comfort and the gospel of grace. May the Lord take His word then and comfort our hearts in our blessed Lord Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless His word to our hearts. Amen. We're going to turn, please, to the hymn 265. 265, "I Stand Amazed in the Presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how He could love me, a sinner, condemned." Just sing the verse 1 of the chorus, the verse 1 of the chorus, and then remain standing, for it, please, for the benediction. 265. We pray, Lord, that our homes will be those places where the Lord is honored, and where grace is continually displayed. Lord, to that end, we cast ourselves afresh upon Thee. Help us to live in the fear of the Lord. Help us, we pray, to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these other things will be added to us. Oh Lord, linger with us through today, we pray. We thank Thee for the refreshments, bless them to us, bless the Sunday school in the adult class, and also the lunch that will follow. We pray, Lord, that Your presence will indeed be known and felt among us throughout the day. And even for the meeting later this afternoon, again, we commit that time to Thee also. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labour is not in vain in the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. My love be with you all in Christ Jesus.